We left off several moons ago, and that is in Matthew 1. And we were talking about the genealogy, and when we ended, okay, we were talking about Matthew's designation of Jesus as the son of Abraham. And that ties back into Genesis, where Abraham was told that he was the one by whom all nations on the earth would bless themselves. And that would be fulfilled in Matthew 2 with the coming of the Magi to add to the flavor of the Hebrew Messiah. And so what we find in that first chapter in particular, the first two chapters, is both Jews and Gentiles present in Matthew's gospel. You have probably heard it said that Matthew's gospel is the Jewish gospel, Luke's is the Gentile gospel. Well, that's an easy statement to make, but it's very difficult in either gospel to back it up completely. Matthew's gospel is not just a Jewish gospel, but he has references and invitations throughout to Gentiles, just as Luke has references and invitations throughout to the Hebrew community. So, we come down to this point where what we need to talk about are the five interesting names in the genealogy. And that is the five women. Four of them, I hid the markers on Wednesday from the kids. Ben, if you're in the little kitchenette, can you hand me the basket with the dry erase markers? Easier said than done, right?
Walked away.
It's up top. Thank you. Okay. There are five women. Their names are Tamar, Rahab, Ruth, the wife of Uriah, and Mary. The four on the left are old, from the Old Testament. Mary, of course, did not play a role in the story as told in the Old Testament. Matthew has taken a few liberties with what is historically known about some of these women, possibly in a byproduct of his using a Greek Old Testament and not always using a Hebrew Old Testament. But what he's doing here is calling attention to the selectivity practiced by God and the work of divine providence in the ancestral listing. So what is the role of these women in all of that? Well, the first thing to say is their presence in this genealogy is unusual. If you go back into 1 Chronicles 2, which has an extensive genealogy, you're not going to find women in it. Tamar, excuse me, that's not fair. In 1 Chronicles 2, you will find Tamar. You won't find the other women. But we still have to say, what do they have in common? Well, Jerome, who lived back around 300 AD and is responsible for translating the Old Testament from Hebrew into Latin and the New Testament from Greek into Latin. Jerome was responsible for the Vulgate Bible. Anyway, Jerome said that the four women were in there because they were sinners, and that this was a sign, again, of God's divine providence, that sinners would be part of the family of Jesus. But when you read about them in the Old Testament, the Bible doesn't always make these Old Testament women sinners. They may have been guilty of what one might call unchastity in varying ways, which I will point out in a minute. But in Jewish piety, they are all made to look good. What did they do? Well, Tamar was to be married to one of the sons of Judah. And, excuse me, Judah decided that he wasn't going to do that. So he didn't marry her to the first one. I stand corrected. She was married to the first one. He died. He then married her to the second son, which is the tradition in ancient Israel. And he died. And Judah had a third son, and he said, I'm not marrying her to my third son. This isn't happening. Well, Tamar knew that her only protection as a Hebrew woman was to have a husband and family. Judah was saying, this isn't happening. So she knew that Judah was going on a trip, and she positioned herself in a town on the route, dressed as a prostitute. And she seduced her father-in-law. And he slept with her. She became pregnant. And she had these children. She had twins. And of course, Judah, the father-in-law, found out that she was pregnant and got into an uproar. How on earth can this happen? You know, get rid of her, kill her, yada, yada, yada. And she said to the emissaries that he sent, she said to them, I can't get rid of these babies, they're his. Trot, trot back. No, they're not, get a grip. Trot, trot back. They're not his. Yes, they are. We'll prove it. When she seduced him, she stole a locket that was part of his baggage. And it was the kind of thing that she knew was important to him, and she was able to produce that as a sign that indeed it was Tamar who slept with Judah. At which point, of course, he said, they're mine and they keep my line alive. Now, if you think back 2 weeks ago, I said that Judah was in here because Judah was one of those important people in the genealogy coming from Abraham to Isaac to Jacob to Judah. Judah was not the firstborn. Jacob was not the firstborn. Isaac was not the firstborn. So Judah had his lineage continued because of Tamar's initiative. Rahab. Well, and let me back up and say, because of her initiative in Jewish literature, she is viewed as a saintly proselyte, somebody who acted on behalf of the Hebrew people. Didn't have to, but went out of her way to be a positive asset for the Hebrew people. Rahab. Well, she's also a proselyte, meaning she wasn't Jewish. We remember her as being a heroine in the victory at Jericho. Matthew says that she is Salmon's wife, but that it could be an error in translation going back to the Greek version that Matthew was using. The Rahab who was victorious at Jericho is reputed to have married Joshua. I wasn't there, I cannot confirm that, but there are sources that believe that that's the case. It doesn't matter because the Rahab to whom Matthew is referring is indeed the woman who hid the spies in Jericho. And then when the powers that be in Jericho learned that there were Hebrew spies in their city and they wanted to get rid of them, it was Rahab who showed them how to go down the back, over the roof, down the back stairs and find a way out of Jericho before the officials could converge on them and arrest the spies. Because she did that, Joshua was able to fight the Battle of Jericho and capture the city. Now, Ruth. Ruth was a Moabite, another proselyte, okay? And Ruth's mother-in-law was Jewish. Her mother-in-law was widowed. Ruth's mother-in-law was Naomi. Naomi had two sons. Ruth was married to one of them. The other son was married to a woman named Orpah, not Oprah. Anyway, both sons were killed, and Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, "You are not Jewish. You do not have to stay with me. Go back to your own people where you should be able to find a husband." Orpah, I'm out of here. Ruth said that famous line, "Wherever you go, I will go, and wherever you live, I will live, and whoever you worship, I will worship." So Ruth threw her lot in with Naomi. Okay, Naomi was your classic mother-in-law. And she was going to work her magic. And so she knew she needed to find a husband for this young daughter-in-law. And as they were traveling, they came to an area where a distant relative of Ruth's, a man named Boaz, was living with his sheep and cattle and all of his herdsmen and the whole nine yards. And so anyway, Naomi pitched her camp there for a while. So Boaz, who was Frederick Buechner in his biography, his short biography of him, says he was a bit long in the tooth. And the truth is Boaz was no spring chicken. He took a shine to Ruth. Ruth said to Naomi, "I don't know what to do." And Naomi said, "This is what you do." She said, "Tonight, you go to his tent, and you enter his tent, and you rub his foot. And whatever he wants, you do." And so Ruth did that, and Boaz decided maybe there's hope yet, and he married Ruth. Now, the whole story is in four chapters in the book of Ruth. You can read it in 15 minutes or less. But what it ends with is, so Boaz and Ruth had a son, and I'm not going to get the names correct, but I believe his name was Salmon. And Salmon had a son, and his name was Obed. And Obed had a son, his name was Jesse, and Jesse had a son, his name was David. So, by doing what her mother-in-law said, which might have been a little scandalous. By doing what her mother-in-law said, Ruth became the great-great-grandmother of David, keeping the line alive. Okay, so we come to the one person in the genealogy who's not identified by her name. Instead, she is called the wife of Uriah. First off, anybody remember what her name really is?
Sheba.
Mm-hmm. Anybody remember why Matthew might refer to her as the wife of Uriah? Very good, Mrs. Wiley. She said they were stupid.
Absolutely.
This is the story of David and Bathsheba. So if you have any doubt about Bathsheba's history, just go read 1 Samuel 2, chapters 11 and 12. It all starts with David out sunning himself on his balcony, peering over the edge into the courtyard next door, and there is Bathsheba taking a bath. And he likes what he sees, and so he sends staff to fetch her. He brings her back, and they had a nice night. And then she tells him a few days later, or not literally days, but she tells him that she's pregnant. Now David has a little bit of a problem, because who is she? She is the wife of Uriah. So David calls on, that's chapter 12. And in chapter 11, he calls on his chief of staff, Ahab, right? I believe it was Ahab. Anyway, he calls on his chief of staff, his version of John Haldeman, okay? And he says to him, I need you to send Uriah into battle and make sure he's at the front of the troops. And if he gets killed, that's so awful. So Uriah is sent into battle. And he doesn't get killed. But they're going back into battle the next day, so he comes home. At which point, David says to Bathsheba, all right, I want you to go back, sleep with Uriah, and then we can say it's his child. Except Uriah is an honorable man. And in those days, if you were going into battle, you did not spend the night before battle engaged in intercourse with your wife. Your focus was on the battle, and you were preparing yourself for what had to be done. So Uriah refused to sleep with her. So David then said, all right, he's at the front, and make sure he's dead. So Uriah was at the front, and he was dead. At which point, as far as David was concerned, the wife of Uriah could now be his wife. And she's pregnant. Isn't this special? I get yet another son. Except, fast forward, the baby is born. Doesn't do well. 7 days later, is dead. And David is beside himself at the loss of the baby. Absolutely beside himself. And that's where chapter 12 of 2 Samuel comes in. That's where Nathan, who is the Lord's prophet, goes to David and tells him the parable of the farmer with the little wee lamb. And he says to David, you know, the other farmer had tons of of lambs to feed his guests. But he took that little wee lamb from that, which was the only thing the other farmer had. And Nathan says to him, "What do you think should be done to the man who took the lamb?" And Nathan said, David said, "He should die. That you can't do that." And then Nathan looks at him and says, "You, David, are the man, but you shall not die." And then the story goes on, that Bathsheba becomes pregnant again. And she has a child, a boy, named Solomon. And later, on David's deathbed, after all the shenanigans of David's other children, continue reading 2 Samuel. There isn't a soap opera as good as 2 Samuel chapters 13 through to the end. But Bathsheba, on David's deathbed, gets David to agree and to sign off that their son Solomon will succeed him. Not any of the other sons from David's other wives. So his youngest son will become the successor to King David. And we all know what happens with Solomon. He finishes the temple. He brings Jerusalem into a level of glory that his father only imagined. He does all of this stuff because the wife of Uriah was able to manipulate things so that her son could be on the crown. When you look in rabbinic literature, she is not always condemned as the wife of Uriah who slept with the next door neighbor, but is often raised to another level because she was the mother of the great King Solomon. So these are the four women from the Old Testament that Matthew has in his gospel. Contrary to what Jerome said, there's little likelihood that Matthew's readers would have viewed these women as sinners. Now, fast forward, Martin Luther argued that they were in the genealogy because they were foreigners, and they all were. So, as far as Luther was concerned, they're in the genealogy to show Jesus, the Jewish Messiah, is related by ancestry to Gentiles. It's a strong theory. But again, it asks us to dig deeper. Could four Old Testament women be there as some kind of preparation for the role of Mary? But as we know, Mary's not a foreigner. It's also not clear that a first century Jew would have regarded these women at this point in the storytelling as foreigners. So a third theory is that there are two common elements between these four Old Testament women and Mary. First, there is something extraordinary, something irregular in their unions with their partners in each and every case. And these unions, though maybe scandalous to outsiders, would continue to bless the lineage of the Messiah. The other thing is that the women showed initiative. And that would play an important part in God's plan for his people. So in that sense, all five are seen as instruments of God's providence. Another aspect to remember is that all of them are seen as examples of the work of the Holy Spirit, even though such language was not there in the Old Testament stories. But they are examples of the work of the Holy Spirit in the sense that they are examples of how God uses the unexpected to triumph over human obstacles. So it's this combination of this irregular, extraordinary, these irregular, extraordinary unions and this divine intervention that explains why they are there in Matthew's genealogy. Now, don't get me wrong, there was a lot of divine intervention in a lot of other Old Testament births. I mean, Sarah did not become pregnant in the normal way. Her daughter-in-law Rebecca didn't, Rachel didn't. But it wasn't scandalous. And in that sense, they're not there in Matthew's genealogy. Scandal seems to be rather important. Why? Because the scandal that we see in the Old Testament women comes around when we look at Mary. They foreshadow the role of Mary. I mean, Mary's pregnancy is scandalous. She's not married. She hasn't lived with her husband. And yet, she tells him that she's pregnant. Not only is she pregnant, but the child was begotten through the Holy Spirit of God. So once more, God has intervened. But this time, even more dramatically, to bring to fulfillment messianic heritage. Now, all five of them are probably here in chapter 1 because they also echo the very last words that we see in Matthew's gospel. So here we've got scandal, we've got Gentiles in chapter 1 in the genealogy of Jesus. And what are the last words that Jesus says in Matthew's gospel? Go therefore into all the world, baptizing and teaching, and lo, I will be with you always to the ends of the earth. In other words, into all the world, not into the Hebrew world, into all the world, into that Gentile world, into the world out of which those women came. In other words, Jesus is saying, be inclusive, at least in Matthew's gospel. Now, just to finish out the genealogy, verses 18 to 25 talk about what is called the Annunciation. And in this case, it's an annunciation to Joseph, not to Mary. In those seven verses, Joseph runs the show. If you think about Luke's annunciation, I think it's always interesting that Luke's annunciation, how many paintings in 2,000 years have been done around Gabriel and Mary? Poor Joe doesn't even get half of a break, does he? I believe that I have seen one painting of an angel talking to Joe. But in Matthew's gospel, Joseph runs the show. And that's true through the birth narrative, because the Annunciation is to him. We then, in chapter 2, we have the arrival of the Magi, and as soon as the Magi are gone, the angel comes back to Joseph and says, get out of here. Get your family and get out of here now. And Joseph does what the angel says, and they are off to Egypt. And then when Herod was dead, the angel comes back to Joseph and says, it is now safe for you to take your family home. So the angel tells Joseph, that God's son is going to be born. The angel tells Joseph, get out of town. The angel tells Joseph, the coast is clear, you can come back. The other thing that we touched on a moment ago is that in chapters 1 and 2, the infancy narratives in Matthew's gospel, Matthew goes to great lengths to be as inclusive of the Jewish people as he is of the Gentiles. And we said 2 weeks ago that, of course, the coming of the Magi there in chapter 2 is the beginning, is the opening sign of that inclusion. Because who were the Magi? Gentiles. Last point that I want to make is where this all goes through the rest of the winter and spring. There are basically four themes that meander through Matthew's gospel. And those four themes are seen in chapters 1 and 2. First, there is an invitation, a theme of invitation, a call to repentance and belief. And that winds its way through Matthew's gospel, and that's there here in the infancy narrative, in the sense of when he lists these people, it is a reminder to his readers that these are people who didn't all have pristine lives. Some of them did indeed have things to repent for. In some of their stories, indeed, there is known punishment, the death of David's first son with Bathsheba. So this theme of invitation is going to be there. There is, in Matthew's gospel, a theme of welcome. And that is characterized by the invitation to sinners and characterized by the forgiveness that is given. You see this in varying stories all through his gospel, especially in some of the parables, which come much later, obviously. He has a third theme, which is challenge. In other words, as he writes his gospel, he is challenging his readers to live as a new covenant people. When you look at the names in chapter 1, and especially when we think of the women, there is a challenge. You can try to hold out that David, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Judah were all pillars of the community. But he's got people in there about whom nothing is known. He's got women in there about whom things are known that aren't necessarily considered normal. And the challenge is for all of that to come together and live as people of this new covenant. And then another theme that Matthew has here is a summons to his readers to assist in the proclamation of the good news. The summons to his readers is to be Jesus's helpers and associates in the mission that he sends them out on at the end of the gospel. That is what those four Old Testament women did. They assisted in the proclamation of God's love for his people. The Magi came and end up being helpers and associates of Jesus. Because if you remember, they were told by an angel, don't go back to Herod. And as the gospel says, they went home on a different way. So as Ben and I, and Ben will be picking up next week, but as we go through, we're going to be looking at stories and how they weave in invitation, welcome, challenge, and summons, and how they may echo some of the things that we've talked about with regard to the story of the genealogy. questions before I head off for the band on any part of Matthew? Questions on anything?
It was very interesting because I always thought that it was like the firstborn of everybody. I've never heard otherwise. It was the firstborn all the way down, and to find out that it wasn't, and then the thought in my head was that Jesse was not the firstborn.
Mm-hmm.
And so I knew it all along, but it never clicked.
Mm-hmm. Well, Jesse wasn't the firstborn, neither was David. David was number seven. No, yeah, number seven. Yeah. We'll get him up there.
That's the one I meant, David.
But I don't think Jesse was firstborn. I could be wrong. But yeah, David was number seven. And you remember the story of the call of David, which actually, if my memory is correct, we're going to read that during Lent, middle of March. And the whole story is the prophet Samuel is sent by God to find the next king. And he goes to Jesse and tells him what he's looking for. And Jesse says, oh, here's my son. He brings in number one, big hulk of a man. Nope, not right. He brings in number two, great violinist or whatever. Nope, not right. Brings in number three, bodybuilder. Nope, not right. Four, not right. Five, not right. Six, not right. These your only sons? Well, no, I got a seventh one. He's just a kid. He's out with the sheep. Bring him in. He brings him in. The Holy Spirit lights on Sam's shoulders. He says, that's the one.
That's the one.
Yeah, we you're right. I think we have a tendency to think in a linear fashion. And what I mean by linear is first to first to first to first to first. And that's partly our Western upbringing, because how do kings and queens of England get on the throne when they don't kill each other first? Right. They get on the throne because they are the firstborn. And what happens when the firstborn decides that he really would rather marry the woman that he loves? The world goes crazy. How can you do this? Oh, well, you know, he was always this, he was always that, you know, that everybody's got to make an excuse for it. But who wouldn't be the queen today if Edward had actually had a child? We would not have Elizabeth on the throne. So it's another one of those stories. I don't remember which author it is, but there is an author who talks about how the story of God is written with crooked lines. And it's a great image to keep in the back of your head for all those times when we want to say it's this, 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 and this. If you go back and read the story of God, it's this, 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 and all over the place. And that genealogy in Matthew 1 is another set of crooked lines. Okay, we're on for next week. No.